Thanks a lot for this very kind introduction, very rich, and for having invited me to the center. I am actually a big fan of the Center for Dependency and Slavery. I'm always following the activities. Actually, it's a great honor to be here as speaker in the James Miller Lecture. Since even though I am a social economic historian of late antiquity and early middle age, actually I have in my shelf at home the big book by Miller on the slave trade in Angola in the early modern period. It's really a guidance for every historian working on in Africa. And connected with Miller's study, even though from a very different perspective, I decided to provide a sample of my study. I already published extensively on North African peasantry, and now I am planning to extend my studies on not just an article, but a larger monograph, which try to summarize the status of question about the North African peasantry from late antiquity to the early middle age. So this paper traces the rise and fall of North African peasantry between the 4th and the 7th century CE. In historiography, this period is generally known as late antiquity. Late antiquity is now seen as an age of agrarian growth, monetary expansion, social mobility, and therefore a relative prosperity for a large part of the population of the Mediterranean basin. In this scenario, North Africa was undoubtedly one of the wealthy provinces. From the 4th to the end of the 7th century, Romans, Vandals, Byzantines ruled the region corresponding to present-day Algeria, Tunisia, and Western Libya. Despite changes in political regime, in economic sphere, continuity, and to some extent prosperity, prevailed. Building on Brent Shaw's seminal study, Bridging in the Sheaves, Economy and Metaphor in the Roman World, this paper argues that late antiquity was the high point of African wage labor participation in the Roman imperial economy. In this period, the percentage of wage labor as part of the economically active population rose consistently. This process is observable elsewhere in the Mediterranean, in the Middle East, from the 5th to the 7th century. While Shaw's study correctly identified the main motors of wage employment and organization of agriculture in the dynamics of the local ecology of harvest cycle, this paper claims that the late antique monetary revolution determined a major reorganization of the rural labor forces. My argument is not that all the sharecroppers, labor tenants, and bonded laborers were wage workers in the sense traditionally attributed to this term, but that this form may reflect the subordination of labor into capital in ways where the sale of labor power for wages is mediated and possibly disguised in more complex arrangements. By more complex arrangements, I mean that without altering the predominance of the mixed labor regime that pulled together tenants, slaves, and wage laborers on the legal framework of the colonate, I will return on this term later, the penetration of money in rural area generated a polarization between two main social classes. They were defined by factors of land or capital on the one end and of labor on the other. The result of this was an increased subordination of peasant labor to coercion, dependent retention, relation, involuntary retention, and at times, proletarization. In order to clarify these complex dynamics, this essay is divided into 7 interconnected sections. Section 1, A Short Economic History of North Africa, offers a brief historical introduction to the economy of the period under scrutiny in this paper. It traces the economic history of North Africa, namely the geographical zone between the Sahara and Mediterranean, from the Roman penetration in the 2nd century BCE to the Arab conquest in the 7th century. I shall admit from the beginning that the balance of this essay is perhaps more on Tunisia and Algeria than on Libya and Morocco. Section 2 presents a summary of the sources for the reconstruction of social economic conditions of North African peasantry, along with some consideration on the problem that this sort of evidence poses to the historians. Section 3 moves from textual and material evidence to the territory by exploring the ecology of the North African landscape, question of climate, the climate change or environmental ecological evolution, and those dealing with the control and exploitation of water, the most vital resources in the ancient Maghreb, are of crucial importance for the pragmatic research on peasantry. Since all these concerns were also linked to the larger problematic of pastoral nomadism in North Africa, Section 4, entitled The Making of a Peasantry, examined the struggle between landowners and pastoralists in the process of creation of rural working communities. Section 5, predictably entitled The Fiction of Rent Tenancy, reconnects agrarian organization and imperial institutional arrangements with the express intent to reject the prevailing historiographical views. First, the dominance of rent tenancy in the late antique agrarian relation. And second, the idea that the transition to gold of the economy, and accordingly to payments of the rent in money, triggered by the late monetary revolution, engendered a widespread prosperity among the peasantry. Section 6, the formal subordination of labor, returned to this problem in greater details, arguing in strong contrast to the prevailing view that the late antique monetary revolution, by creating a dual economy, determined an increase in socio-economic divergence between large landowners and the rural labor force. This process was partly masked by what I call an early prosperity, but in reality it bears witness to a transition from tax rent extraction to direct exploitation of peasant labor, regardless of a certain degree of stability in the legal or contractual condition of the workers. The final section 7, What Happened to Slavery, completes my picture of the world of peasant labor by restoring the key role of slave workers in the late antique North Africa. Despite numerically non-predominant, rural slaves worked alongside abundant peasants in the cash crop production from the 4th to the 7th century. In the transition from the Byzantine to the Arab rule, however, there was a major shift from slaves employed as a labor power to slaves sold as a market commodities. This was the short overview of the paper. Now I will give a short summary of the economic history of North Africa in order to create a framework in which I can insert the other information. The Roman colonization of North Africa dates back to the 2nd century BCE after the Romans destroyed Carthage in the Third Punic War and occupied Tunisia and western Libya. The Numidian kingdom in the eastern Algeria was annexed in the 5th century BCE, while Mauritania, comprising western Algeria, the present-day Morocco, was fully absorbed in the middle of the 5th century CE. Much of the land was actually organized in the form of large imperial estates, which were subsequently leased out to private individuals, usually senators, under longer-term emphyteutic leases. Under the early empire, the region wealth was successively channeled to the landholding senator, the curions, and of course of the imperial government. One of the main factors of the agrarian production were the in-kind contribution of foodstuff to the city of Rome, the so-called nona. Even if a large part of this agrarian produce was delivered in the form of taxes, Afro-Roman landowners had enough left over to engage in commerce from which they derive enormous profit. The actual workers were primarily free peasants who acted as sharecroppers or seasonal farm laborers for their city-dwelling landlords. From the early 4th century onwards, this situation changed. The constant monetary revolution and the rapid but incomplete transition to gold of the imperial economy caused a major reorganization in the agrarian production, without reducing the share of the harvest to be delivered to Rome in the form of in-kind contributions, moved by a new acquisitive attitude towards in-gold remunerations, Afro-Roman landowners increased their involvement in the commercialized agriculture, as we shall see, this participation implied in turn a restructuring of the labor relation in the late antique countryside. The Vandal conquest of the core province of North Africa between the 430s and the 440s had both elements of continuity and radical change. The Vandal acquisition of the region by direct conquest had as an important implication the dispossession of numerous of Roman landowners. Confiscation particularly targeted the senators, imperial officers and the wealthy municipality of Carthage. The Vandal king distributed his estate, called Sortes Vandalorum in the Victor Vita work, to his army, the Arian Church. Yet, despite the enabled suffering experienced by many Afro-Roman landowners and the Catholic clergy, the Vandal occupation didn't revert the basic economic structure. The North African economy actually appeared to have improved in those areas under direct Vandal rule. With the discontinuation of the unknown to Italy, actually, the grain partly delivered to the form of tax to Rome, a favorable balance of trade return. Landlords had at their disposal a larger share of their produce to sell in the Mediterranean market. In those regions outside direct Vandal control, such as the Mauritanias and Tripolitania, Mediterranean trade declined. Thought there was perhaps a compensating increase in new regional trade networks, Trans-Saharan in particular. The Laguatan Confederation, an alliance of the Libyan tribes, linked the caravan routes across the Sahara to the agricultural settlement of the pre-desert, in a way that presaged the more famous Gold Road of the Middle Ages. Trading towns like Gennegenno grew up on the River Niger, owing to their economy based on the exchange of trade goods across the Sahara. After numerous attempts, the Eastern Imperial conquest of North Africa in the 530s, under the tenure of the Imperial Justinian, opened a new economic phase. Imperial reoccupation reoriented the trade toward east, causing inevitably a decline of the export to the Western Mediterranean. However, the archaeological record signal a decline in both production and circulation, which seems to be part of a more general tendency that had invested the entire Mediterranean in the second half of the 6th century. The regressive economic cycle was partly reverted by the early 7th century, when the future Roman Emperor of Heraclius sailed from North Africa to Constantinople in 608, Carthage was still the largest city in the Western Mediterranean. Behind it was a prosperous interland which provided much of the economic strength of the empire. From the 640s onwards, because of the Sassanian occupation of Egypt and the Arab conquest of the Middle East, North Africa and Sicily became the granaries of the Eastern Empire. A set of changing tax regimes, the most important of which was the deregulation of in-kind taxation, made the tax supply system a source of enrichment for the landed elites involved in the provision of the state. The productive capacity to respond to the state demand as an indicator of that larger state commercialized agriculture continued to function without interruption. Not even the Arab conquest in the second half of the 7th century destroyed such agricultural infrastructures, despite the demise of the imperial commercialized fiscality linked to the supply of the state apparatuses. Agrarian infrastructure continued functioning into the late 7th century, and there is some evidence from after the Arab conquest suggesting some state remained intact. There were, of course, numerous changes. As we shall see in the last section of this paper, the ongoing World War and the slave raiding caused a shift in the export of commodities and import of slaves, which was followed, according to some scholar, by a breakdown in social cohesion and accelerated collapse of the economy during the 8th century. From the perspective of the organization of the labor force, to simplify, oversimplify, from being a major pool of attraction for servile labor force, the Maghrib became an important hub from which slaves were delivered to the Eastern market. Let's now take a look at the sources on which this study is based. The sources for the study of North African peasantry in the Roman period are, of course, problematic. Despite a rich documentary and epigraphic record for North Africa, Little of it relate to the rural population. Though the late Roman texts discuss peasants more extensively the early sources, as Leslie Dawsey, a perceptive remark, most of our evidence fall into the category of what James Scott has characterized as public transport of power relations, or accounts mediated by the interpretation of the dominant elites, as opposed to the hidden transcript or the opinion of the peasant themselves. Because we have nearly no text written by peasants themselves, we need to rely on description by others. Such public transcripts are not necessarily hostile toward their subject. However, they tend to define peasant from a top-down perspective. They don't provide the peasant Owen vision of the world. In ecclesiastical literature, which constitutes the majority of our Owen resources, peasants are likely to be idealized as demonized. Both Optatus from Milevis, writing in the 4th century, and Augustine, Bishop of Hippo in Numidia, active in the early 5th century, shared this ambivalent view of the rural laborers, and the hired workers in particular. Legal evidence is a far richer, but no less problematic. There is a large dossier of imperial decree addressed to North African provinces covering the entire period from the 300 to 700, to 600, sorry. Although they are all written from the imperial perspective, they are helpful as they refer to the system of land tenure, to the obligation of the peasants, to their degree of social and geographical mobility. Epigraphic sources complement legal evidence, offering two types of information. Monumental inscription illuminate the bottom-up trajectory of social mobility. The Maktar Harvester inscription, to which I shall return below, narrate the story of a peasant at seasonal labor who became member of the local senate of his hometown. I will suggest that this successful story is more an indicator of the general trend of the economy and of change in labor regime rather than a mark of the degree of social improvement of the peasantry as class. Ostraca and other materials record agricultural contract, receipt of payment, wages, or other type of economic transaction. It's worth remarking, however, that since this document has had a template the Roman legislation, numerous forms of labor subordination were described according to a standard model, if not they escaped from traditional recording. Given the limitation of this evidence, this essay combines all the available material with the intent of verifying or falsifying their contribution to the world of labor. Coinage served this purpose very well. Coinage is widely regarded as an historical indicator of economic activity, reflecting pattern of exchange, condition of supply and demand, or monetization of wages. Coinage, money means economy, but economic exchange is not the whole story. My aim is to demonstrate that the coinage was not just not a neutral means of exchange, but rather a tool in the hands of the ruling classes that helped to create social relation of dependence. Given its highly stratified monetary system, North Africa's scenario is an excellent laboratory for this purpose. Another source of material history of the peasant is archaeology. In the past, archaeology in North Africa has concentrated on the superficial aspect of the urban settlement, the towns and their monumental decoration, whereas non-elite sites such as village, farm and hamlets have been scarcely considered. However, recent archaeological surveys have been carried out with the express purpose to reconstruct rural settlement patterns. For the Maghrib, there have been surveys in the region of Carthage, Bullareggia, Sufetula, Kilium, Sergernes, Touga, Djerbat, and many others. This excavation has provided a series of key information concerning the agrarian infrastructure, processing and production center, such as presses, storage facility or irrigation system, the vessel for the wine, oil or salsamenta, and no less important, the vernacular architecture, say the housing of the ordinary peasants. This element helps to illuminate the link between the agrarian infrastructure and the organization of the labor force. In lex abstract term, the people, the number, the geographic distribution, and the relation between them and the lands they occupy constitute the first indication of the social condition of production and labor organization. North Africa was the roughly 2,500 kilometer long coastal plain between the Atlas Mountains and the Mediterranean, stretching, as the chart shows, from the Gulf of Gabes in Libya to the Moroccan Atlantic. It was separated from the rest of the African continent by the Sahara, which had become the world's most extensive desert sometime after the 3000 BCE. In eastern Libya, the desert reached nearly the sea, and this caused it another barrier between Latin North Africa and Greek, Cyrenaica, and Egypt, which were culturally and administratively distinct. There were four main ecological zones: the immediate Mediterranean coast, a chain of relatively fertile hills and valleys that is known as the Tell in Algeria and becomes the hilly plateau of Jebel in Libya, the third, the open plains and steppe known as Sahel in Tunisia, and the arid pre-desert. Level of precipitation were a basic prerequisite for determining North Africa division in various agricultural zones. Regions situated above 600 mm per annum hydrosweat can be considered as belonging to the true Mediterranean regime. This implied that sufficient rain fell on the coast and the tell to allow for dry cultivation of Mediterranean crop, such as grain, olives, figs, fruit trees, and vines. For another 100-200 kilometers southward, an isoet of 200-500 millimeters of annual rainfall allowed for irrigated agriculture, which gradually took off under the stable security situation provided by the Romans, reaching an apex in the 3rd century. This more marginal steppic land, as for example in the western Byzacena, tended to favor oliculture rather than grain production. The more arid plains and pre-desert required hard labor to support a large settled population, although by channeling the seasonal stream called wadis that flowed from the mountains, farmers could achieve remarkable high yields. Beyond this, to the south, the region falling below the 100 mm rainfall per annum threshold can be regarded as desert. The desert was accessible only to the pastoralist nomads, who were themselves very much part of the region economy as they entered and exited the arable territory, interacting with the agricultural neighbors, occasional laborers, traders, or raiders. The pastoralists who continued to cross the Sahara even after its desertification brought the region major social wealth, trade goods such as ivory, gold, and slaves from sub-Saharan Africa. Transit across the desert westward to the Nile and southward to the central and western Africa had never wholly ceased. It became easier to the widespread use of the horse and the camel in the course of the 5th millennium BCE. So, I did this long introduction to the landscape and to the economic, general economic history of North Africa in order to introduce the variety of North Africa rural landscape, which was a rich and complex tapestry of agricultural forms. This implied that given the heterogeneity of its hydrological condition, it's hard to believe that owners would have adopted a single pattern of labor use across diverse ecological zones. Where different crops predominated, and labor requirement varied correspondingly. The organization of the estate must have been determined crucially by the use of labor. Olive cultivation required large inputs of seasonal labor, but only a small permanent staff. On the other hand, arable production required more stable inputs of labor and a greater continuity of relationship. Owners of vineyard and arable estates faced a more complex schedule of labor demands, combined different categories of labor, and were preoccupied with the average level of effort. In this region, stable working communities were essential, and creating such community was doubtless one of the major hurdles large landowners faced in the countryside still dominated by pastoralism. They seemed on the whole to have succeeded. Traditional nomadism have been hemmed in and rigidly circumscribed. The 3rd century Christian author Tertullian described the Maori and the Getuli, two Berber tribes from Algeria and Libya respectively, as living under siege. The carving up of their land had certainly begun by the early 2nd century and continued without interruption for the remaining century of the Roman rule. There were massive estates called villa, owned by various members of a single local family. They were a significant group of African-born senators, representative of a large body of private estate holders. These people were active in the development of rural infrastructure, which required substantial investment in loco, but which operated always with an economic framework that depended on the Mediterranean market and the state demand. The management of this estate was closely similar to, if not modeled on, that of the imperial estate, which formed about 1/6 of the total land area of present-day Tunisia, something corresponding to 15,000 square kilometers. A villa-focused settlement pattern was not necessarily one where a great state controlled a landscape, but it was certainly one where the state ran from the that villa, whether a single block of land or more often a scatter of property, was the major point of reference in terms of management of the agrarian production, in type of crop, scale of production, access to market, organization of the labor, so using slave, permanent labor, seasonal daily work, and collection of rent and taxes. A vast amount of evidence associates individual estate with rural villages, vici, in the surrounding area. A famous passage in the Agrimensores, a Roman book on, on land surveying, which collected a variety of numerous authors describing the agricultural operation, describe private owners controlling large working population and villages around the central estate. In the late empire, the countryside of Numidia, where transhumance had been strongest, comprised countless number of estate communities who indeed even identified themselves by the employer name of the name of the state. A scattered number of the epigraphic sources have transmitted their name, the Volusianenses for the employees of the Fundus Volusianus, or the Vesatenses for the estate of Caio Annius Anullinus. Similarly, a conceptual geography based on fundi, a space for smaller properties, but the privileged landowning over the all other form of geographical collective identity. Of critical importance is the observation that growth of private landholding in some area may have achieved at the expense of the previous communal pattern of land use. Tribal ownership and control of lands, and notably water resources, may increasingly give way to a state owned by an elite or favored group within the community. This doesn't mean that peasant communities acting autonomously cease to exist. The rural communities called Castellani were the remarkable expression of the tremendous spirit of independence of the local inhabitants. Religious dissent, most notably in the form of Donatism, drew on the strength of these communities and gave them a wider sense of solidarity, both among themselves and against the landlords of the and the towns. These people usually reside in a rural settlement called in Latin sources Castella, like the Castello of Fussala described by Augustine, Bishop of Hippo in Numidia, in his letter written in the early 5th century. Within these communities, transhumance survives was probably, next to seasonal labor, the essential means of subsistence of the Castellani. The harvest gang resided on a state on a seasonal basis, where they were hosted in provisional shelter called the Mapalia in Punic or Case in Latin. When they formed the permanent estate were forks, like the colony of the Fundus Togonetensis, they lost part of the autonomy and geographical mobility, but not necessarily the identity that came to coincide with the state of their state of residence. The transition from tribesmen to peasant, or the positive response by Africans to market opportunity offered by the establishment of large estate and the commercialization of the agriculture, is the crucial point of this investigation. But it should be clear that this could arguably be studied without reference to the subsequent checking or failure of that response. In the following section, I shall indicate the chronological spatial incidence of a characteristic early prosperity in the peasant's response, as well as the natural timing of the subsequent decline or blunting of that response. Implicit in this concern is a disaffection with dualism or neo-institutional theory as an explanation of pre-modern African history, and a reluctance to project into the past, the underdevelopment and disability of a particular region or sector of the contemporary economy. So from this point onward, I move to late antiquity, to the core of the paper. The economic transition to late antiquity was characterized by two principal factors. In the early 4th century, the constant monetary revolution engendered a rapid but uneven shift to the economy based on gold. This process was accompanied by the enforcement of a body of law, collectively called colonnade, aimed at regulating the mobility and the obligation of the peasantry in the new economic setting. The aim of this section is to connect these two factors with the question of peasant exploitation in late antiquity. This purpose calls into question both the discussion about the demonization of the economy and the late Roman colonnade. To oversimplify, the late antique monetary revolution marked the shift from a bimetallic system to a monetary organization based on gold. State office holders and the members of the local elite ran this transition to gold, from which they derived enormous profit. Since the transition to gold of the economy was never complete, the state of affairs allowed the holders of gold to retain a social and economic control over the peasantry, which was further reinforced by the colonnade body of legislation. In the endless debate about the nature of the colonnade, the key question regarding the peasantry was whether the state should preserve their freedom or allow the landowning elite to enslave or slave them. One position has argued that the interest of the state generally lay in keeping them free, that is, under the direct control of the state for purposes of taxation, compulsory labor, and military service. On the other hand, a second view has contended that the freedom of the peasantry sometimes had to be sacrificed in order to buy elite support, and there were also times when the state was simply too weak to prevent the landowning class from inserting itself between the peasants and the central administration. Regardless of the vicissitude of the peasants, they might be free, dependents, or slaves, these two schools of thought seem to agree on one key point. The state, the landholding class, extracted from them agrarian surplus in form of tax or rent. The predominance of this view has an important implication, that when one moves on to explore the labor relationship in the late antique countryside, one looks at them as they were all regulated according to the legal scheme of, provided by tenancy. The producers in such a society were largely peasant families interested primarily in producing their own subsistence. State and landlord coerced from them in the form of rent or tax, imposed either directly or indirectly part of the surplus they produced. Capital did exist under such a regime, but it operated in the form of merchant or financial capital, facilitating the exchange of commodities and the provision of credits. Capital made itself felt at the level of exchange relation, but since it didn't enter into the sphere of production, it didn't cause any transformation in the social structure. In essence, the only change in this transition was a transition from in-kind to in-cash payments, regarding both tax and rent. In recent study, Lelis Dosey had applied this conceptual framework to North Africa in late antiquity. She has argued, owing to an increased modernization and change in tax assessment, the North African peasantry experienced a real consumption revolution in late antiquity. Peasants' access to commodities like fine wares was weak in the early empire period because the Roman order had limited the ability to consume anything beyond the most basic necessities. Pattern of commodity distribution and production changed in late antiquity. The small farm and villages that had been all but archaeologically invisible during the early empire period began to obtain durable fine wares by the late 4th century. There are signs of other forms of material culture, glass, root tiles, bathhouses, clothing, and money itself were becoming available to rural population. Some of these developments might be attributed to a general increase in wealth in the core of African provinces, derived from the expanding overseas export. This change became possible because the widespread of monetization, the change in tax assessment, the increased possibility for the peasant to pay their taxes and rent in money, rather than in kind, and therefore to deliver the agricultural products to the market instead of delivering it in the form of taxes to the state or rent to the landlords. Because of this change, on the one hand, the social and geographical distance between landlords and their peasants became greater than in the early empire. On the other hand, however, political and social constraints on peasant consumption had begun to break down. Dossey's thesis is compelling in many respects. Numismatic and archaeological evidence suggests that the North African countryside was fully integrated into the Mediterranean market economy. Circulation of commodities and petty coins also resource the marginal areas on the southern border. The critical point of her thesis is that she didn't take into account that the penetration of money in the regional economy not only determined a shift from in-kind to cash payments, but rather engendered a major change in the labor relationship. Building on this foundation, in the next section, Achel argued that there was an initially positive response by African peasants to economic change and market opportunities, which partly justify the early prosperity argued by Dossey. That an adapted form of prevailing subsistence method provide hundreds of thousands of African peasants with a preferable alternative to wage labor on large landowner's terms in the form of limited participation in the produce market. As Shelp specified, the peculiarity of the sale of labor power in a regime dominated by a slaveholding mentality reinforced by the colonial legislation. I shall also argue that a small group of peasants made considerable adaptation, departing entirely from traditional subsistence agrarian economy. On the other hand, however, this process saw the emergence of a new pattern of social relation between the landlords and the rural labor force, accompanied by social differentiation among its members and in some circumstances by partial proletarization. One of the main features of the transition to an economy based on gold was that the very existence of exchange value as a massive economic fact tended to transform the attitude of the economic actors, producers as well as merchants. It became possible to seek rich, not just in the form of accumulation of goods, land and slave remain important, of course, but in the very convenient and mobile form of money, the bulk of which consists of gold. The possession of monetary wealth soon became an end in itself in the exchange economy, and this transformation affected also who were immediately involved. Hence, not only merchants and traders, but also members of the traditional order, the landholding elites, including the emergent cadre of the state apparatuses, acquired what today we would call a business-like attitude toward economic affairs. This change involved the standardization of manufacture and mass productivity, which generated in turn a propensity to structure labor processes in a way that ensure the maximal efficiency of the labor workforce. There is a vast amount of evidence on the impact produced by monetary penetration in the late antique production and agrarian relation. There are indications that wealthy landowners run their estate in larger operational unit in order to maximize production and profit. The scale of seasonal labor demands produced by them require very large numbers of men to be on the move each summer to reap the cereal crops. To give some estimates, Brent Shaw has calculated that given the extension of the North African land, landowners require to mobilize a workforce of around 1 million men for reaping process of the cereal alone. The pool of these agricultural workers were various: small peasants, tenants, landless workers resident in the Castella or farther south to the border. According to the Christian bishop Optatus from Milevis, writing in the 340s, these laborers habitually gathered at local periodic market centers like the town of Baghdad, which is here on the map in the center, and this is Maktaris, the other important city of the harvester. Writing in this lab habitually gathered the local period marker sand, like the town of Baghdad I was mentioning in southern Nubia, precisely because the local market functioned as a labor exchange where landowners and the agent could acquire reapers on a daily basis. Several hundred of thousands of these workers were mobilized, but only a small group of them derived considerable advantage from the new agrarian system. The most famous figure is probably the Maktar harvester, whose story is recorded in an inscription the Brent show as related to this period. Written as a first-person narrative, the poem recounts the rag-to-rich story of a poor peasant who rose from tilling a small plot of land and working as an itinerant farm worker to become a respected citizen of means and social ranks in his hometown. While this example shows that as individual, the laborer could improve his social status, the story also reinforced the view that this social upsurge necessarily implies as a precondition the exploitation of labor force as class. What should impress us while reading this source is not the individual social rise of our harvester, but the fact this story was successful because of the massive mobilization of labor and greater control exerted over the workers by the property classes. Having set out this general trend, I can now turn to the specific of labor relationship. In the introduction, I have anticipated that the massive mobilization of labor force contributed to the subordination of the peasant to the large landowners, without necessarily reducing them to the status of wage workers. I argue for more subtle form of labor subordination. To further elaborate this view, I refer back to an early study written by Jaros Banagi on the problem of penetration of capital in the world of peasantry. In contrast to the thesis upholding the separation between production and merchant capital, which I have summarized earlier, Banagi has suggested that the penetration of capital in the form of money lending has brought about an important change in the world of peasant production. He distinguished two stages in the historical process, whereby capital cites all of existing labor practice and subordinates them to the creation of surplus value. The first stage was the development of formal subsumption of labor to capital, and the second was the realization of the real subsumption, which referred to the completion of the commodity relation and capital capacity to produce its own presupposition, making its installation as mode of production. Formal subsumption occurred with the initial encounter of capital and small producer, the moment when the merchant capital invaded to cover the process of production, without subjecting it to the technological transformation. The existence of these two regimes of subordination, formal and real, introduces us the important distinction between the notion of absolute surplus value and relative surplus value. The first concept identified the surplus extracted by lengthening the workday as much as possible, which is of interest to us here, whereas the second, for the surplus extraction, depended on more on the application of technology and means, but didn't necessarily mean that there was less extortion or exploitation of the labor force. Moving from theory to practice, in Banagi's explanation of the function of the late antique state and the formation of the labor force, what really matters is not the formal contractual condition of the laborers, the majority of whom were evidently neither wage laborers nor landless peasants, but the dynamics of their subordination to economic coercion and to merchant capital in particular. Smallholding peasants and tenants are not to be reduced to proletarianized wage laborers, as they would have been under a regime of real subsumption, but surplus value was being extracted from them through debt interest. In less abstract term, the growing indebtedness of peasants to money lenders for advanced loans made their agricultural produce hostage to repaying interest. A clear indication of the state of affairs in the North African countryside come from the testimony of Optatus of Milevis, who refer to debt slaves who were seeking freedom from the unjust treatment imposed on them by the term of debt bondage. The whole context of this testimony excites the strongest suspicion that the slaves were not chattel slaves, as is normally thought. It is most probable that the documents, so the tabule, that the peasant workers destroyed were records of deeds owed by them to landlords. Supplementing Banaji's thesis, I argue that the key in the process of subordination of labor to debt was not only the ominous condition of repayment imposed on the peasants, but above all the threatening combination between the former and the colonnade regulation, which entitled the landlords enormous power, judicial, fiscal, physical, over their peasant. One of the to take just one example among the many, 140th century normative regulation relating to farm tenants in North Africa, a fragment of a decree of Valentinian I issued in 366 to the governor of Tripolitania, is relieving of this state of affairs. This decree orders estate holders, domini, to accept tax payment for their peasant, rustici in this case, in kind, not to demand cash. In this situation, the scheme of tenancy included and concealed a form of labor subordination. For instance, the contract of employment often involved an advance payment of wage, as Banaji has correctly argued. Sometimes, as this seems the case of our law, the contract of employment involved the payment of taxes through the intermediation of the landlords, which anticipated the due amount to the tax collector. This system entitled the landlords to the right of retaining the peasant worker until the debt has been repaid. The advanced system operated within the context of tenancy labor, rent tenancy. In this case, the advance payment of wage or taxes, there is no distinction in terms of power of retention, both in cash or in kind, took the form of a consumption loan, which had the aim of strengthening the employer control over the employee. In this way, the employer became creditor, but his essential interest was the extraction of labor. This combination between extra-economic and economic coercion created the atypical coexistence between a large migrant and merely landless labor force and a system designed to retain them on the state, which expressed intent to extract from them labor. It's worth noting that this mode of surplus extraction remained largely unaffected by change in political regime. I cannot enter into the details of each single system. Now, for present purpose, it suffice to say that in the period following the Roman rule, under the Vandals, the Byzantine, and as Eduardo Manzano Moreno has convincingly demonstrated, also under the early Arabic rule, the control exerted by a privileged group over the monetary wealth, and the mainstream coinage in particular, reinforced the control over the labor force, along with a profitable access to the commercialization of agrarian products. Interesting comparison exists in modern period, where a somewhat similar system of exploitation was in place. In the late 5th century, Tunisia, there was a particular category of rural worker called Kamma. This worker was defined as an associate having the right to 1/5 as compensation of his work. A kamas was the one who provided the labor, and the owner or the fellah who hired him provided the other 4 elements necessary for farming: land, draft animal, plows or other implements, and seed. The kamas constituted 1/5 of the investment that his compensation amounted theoretically to 1/5 of the harvest. The employer's obligation to the kamma, to this worker, were first to pay him an advance in cash, second to buy a beast of burden to transport his personal to his new dwelling, and finally to give him his share after the harvest. The kamma, however, even when he fulfilled all his duty, was still not free of his obligation. Before the end of the season, he had also to inform the farmer of his intention to leave, and above all, to reimburse the funds advanced to him. The keystone of this partnership was precisely the advance made to the kamas. Finally, in the last section, we shall ask how widespread was slavery in late antiquity. The quick answer is that even though traditional narrative argue for a decline of the slave plantation system after the second century CE, in reality slavery continued without interruption, and slave labor was extensively deployed in late antiquity. Without questioning the persistence of slavery as an institution in late antiquity, various scholars have discounted equally its significance. According to the dominant historiographical position, which pulled together scholars of diverse ideological background, slaves of the later Roman Empire or in the subsequent period were for the most part anything in their tenants. The moment the landlord provided the slave with a family plot, the latter became a servus quasi colonus. In this capacity, the slave organized his farming practice and the family structure. The combination between a greater autonomy for what can be called after the individual land assignment a peasant and the end of effective intervention by the landlord in the procedure of production would transform the entire logic of economic system. In essence, the majority of servi mancipia were tenants who controlled the overholdings and could keep its fruit after rent were paid to the landlords. With little basis in the evidence and less conceptual support, this evolutionary model of change misrepresented the exploitative condition of the rural labor force, and at the same time, it also oversimplified the actual transition from Roman to medieval relation of production. Late Roman slavery did not become medieval serfdom, and late antiquity was not an intermediate stage between late antiquity and Middle Ages. Kyle Harper had taken a very different position and suggested that slavery had a crucial importance in cash crop agriculture. He has calculated that in 4th century Roman world, there was around almost 5 million slaves over a total population of around 50 million. Most notably, Harper has pointed out that the wealthiest 1.3% of the Roman society owned the 49% of the slaves. In many circumstances, they formed the backbone of the agrarian labor force of the larger state. Even though rural slaves accounted for something like 6% of the total rural population, they were over the 20% of the total labor force on elite estate, a percentage would have been higher in core region of the market-oriented production, lower in the peripheral area. In a perceptive exam from which the management of the labor organization of late 4th century Asia Minor state is the empirical reference, Harper has argued that slave labor was decisive in the profitable cash crop enterprises that rewarded control of the production, primarily cereals, wine and oil. Another major feature of Harper's view of slave labor is that the slave household was self-reproducing, and that in turn external source of slave had a marginal role. Harper's model is brilliant, but requires some qualification the moment we apply his figures to the North African rural scenario. Evidence for North Africa suggests three main trajectories. Slaves represented a minority among the laborers employed in the state. Fundamentally, bond peasants rather than slaves worked in North Africa agricultural estate in the 4th to the 6th century. This not to deny that slaves were still used in North African agriculture. In two laws of donatism, issued in 412 and 414, the emperor, his agent, conceived of slaves and colony could be used indifferently to cultivate farmstead. But slaves seem having occupied a specific function in the productive system. They were the most skilled component of the rural labor force, and as such, they were ordinarily charged with the maintenance of the agrarian infrastructure, such as presses, mill, irrigation system, and the supervision of mobile workforce. Slaves represented a profitable mobile force from which the landlord could derive additional profit when they were not directly occupied in the agricultural operation on his own estate. They were periodically hired out in exchange for daily wage. The thesis recently reproposed by Peter Temin, that slaves could easily buy their freedom using their money accumulated in their personal coffer, the so-called peculium, is another historiographical myth. In late antiquity, the landlords acquired even more control over the labor of his slaves rather than in the early time, except for a few limitations imposed by the fiscal law. Notably, Brent Shaw had drawn attention to numerous mentions of slaves, terminus mercenari, whose labor was hired out by contractors who were them. So, the commercialization of agriculture engendered a process of commodification of labor, which didn't take into account the legal condition of the worker. The last point concerns the source of reproduction of the slave labor. In North Africa, the primary means of reproduction was the external supply. Rather than relying on the fertility of slave households, landlords counted on import, purchasing the market, and in certain circumstances, in enslavement. Sometimes the two forms were linked, as in the case of the Vandals. There is abundant evidence that Vandals enslaved many Afro-Roman residents. Our sources emphasize that enslavement involved members of elite, but there are also indications that captive taking and enslavement occurred in a more generalized level. Under Vandal rule, enslavement was used as a standard form of punishment for political and religious dissenters. But slaves were also imported through trade, and the Vandals engaged in regular raids on the coast of Sicily, Lucania, Brutium, and other places, which netted not just plunder, but also large numbers of captives. According to Victor of Vita, in 455, Rome yielded thousands of captives, some of which wound up on the Mediterranean slave markets. Others were distributed to slave owners and were likely deployed in agriculture. Although the evidence for the use of agricultural slaves under Vandals is tenuous, it would seem that the period of intense enslaving led to an intensification of the use of slave labor in the regional agriculture. In the aftermath of the Eastern Imperial Conquest in the 6th century, the evidence of activity resulting in enslavement of the captive diminished substantially. The main concern of the imperial administration seems to the restoration of regard to the productivity of the state and the tax system. But import of slaves continued from the Iberian Peninsula and Gaul in exchange for North African agricultural products. Total minority of this rural rebel force, slaves appear to continue to play an important role in North African commercialized agriculture in the early 7th century. Thomas McMaster suggested that a major shift in the makeup of the laboring force took place in the course of the 7th century, late 7th century. While at the beginning of the 7th century, North Africa appeared to have been an area to which slaves were imported, by the second half of the century, it had to become one of the chief regions of the export. African imports continued to appear in Italian and Gallic contests up to the very end of the 7th century. Though in the second half of the century, they had begun to a precipitous decline when the slave trade shifted dramatically. The Arab westward advance was both cause and effect of a change in the flow of servile labor. McMaster, working on Pirentesi, is brilliant, but the motivation of the shift in the makeup of the laboring force seems to lie more on the development of Saharan route than in the decline of the Mediterranean trade. In this development, the slave trade seems to have played a key role. When the Arabs subjected to the Garamantes, a group living south Tripolitania controlling trans-Saharan trade, they agreed to annual tribute in slave. The people of the houses of Vadan, Germa, and Kavar each provided 360 slaves per year. As their population was small, these slaves probably were brought north from regions beyond the Sahara. These agreements are among the early evidence for the export of black Africans through the agreement that slavery already existed. Accordingly, Byzantine historian Theophanes, similar agreements were made also in the 651 with the Nubian kingdom. So in conclusion, more than the decline of Mediterranean trade, it was the open up of the Saharan trade that produced this shift. To conclude, the main argument of running to this this essay was an increased monetization of the economy and the emergence of a commercialized agriculture that demanded a major shift in labor relationship. In strong contrast to the predominant which saw late antiquity as a period of social growth from the peasantry, including the servile component, this essay claims that there are enough evidence suggesting that a process of commodification of labor was in motion. In this scenario, the landholding elite reinforced the control of the labor force, regarding the persisting distinction in the condition of the workers. Changes in the makeup of the labor regime was mainly determined by the response of North African landowners to market demand and by the arrangement the political order enacted in order to allow the landowner to react successfully against this demand. Thanks a lot. Sorry for the late.